Our first reading this morning is Psalm 118. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. Out of my distress I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. With the Lord on my side, I do not fear. What can mortals do to me? The Lord is on my side to help me. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in mortals. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees. They blazed like a fire of thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does valiantly. I shall not die, but I shall live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of the righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. O give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his steadfast love endures forever.
Thank you, Jen. We read that whole psalm because it is a processional psalm. It is a psalm that was used in ancient royal processions that the king, guided by the people of the city, would walk all the way up to the temple proclaiming this psalm and using this psalm. And Palm Sunday is a day in which Jesus is using the imagery of processions in order to make a new claim. So I just wanted to give us that sort of context, that processional psalm context. And there are a couple of things to highlight. This idea of total dependence on God, that it's not in our own might, but in God's might. And this idea that the stone that the builders have rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Now, I'm going to read our gospel passage for today, which comes from the book of Mark. And as I read it, I want you to just listen for the word palm. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this: 'The Lord needs it, and will send it back here immediately.'" They went away and found a colt tied near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing, untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who followed were shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the word of the Lord. My church in Philadelphia used to do this thing every Palm Sunday where we would go to Rittenhouse Square with a couple of other churches, and we would have a procession out there. So we would go, and there'd be a few, you know, brass pieces and a few people from a few churches. None of the churches were all that big, and it was kind of in between the services. We all had our own services to go to. And so, you know, it was just kind of a small collection of people. And we would come in, and we would say a few words, and then we would make a procession around Rittenhouse Square. To be honest, I always felt like it was a little bit meh. Because it's a small group of people, and it's, you know, we're singing, but none of us are really that comfortable singing without, like, a lot of vocal support. So everybody's kind of half singing. You people are walking their dogs around us, you know, and of course, when somebody's walking their dog around you, then you really sing quietly. It's just, it always felt a little bit kind of dinky. And I tried to do some things. I had some ideas to maybe spruce it up. By the way, do you know how hard it is to rent a donkey in Philadelphia? it's not feasible, so that was out. But we made some paper plate tambourines, and, you know, 9 paper plate tambourines just made the whole procession even dinkier. And I always just kind of felt like this didn't really do the story justice. Because I grew up on these stories of all of Jerusalem coming out and it being this massive procession and this huge deal. And I just felt like walking around Rittenhouse Square, where the only people that ever saw us were people that happened to be getting coffee at that exact moment. It wasn't impressive like it ought to be. And I want to make this suggestion, because I've spent a lot of time reading up on this in the last few years, and even more so in the last week, is that Jesus's procession, the original one, was in fact kind of dinky itself. So every parade has sort of a ritual language that it uses, and we're all familiar with the ritual language of parades that we're in. So, for example, yesterday, if you were in Washington, D.C., or Haddon Lake, or Philly, or New York, or any number of places where there were a ton of people walking around with signs written on cardboard and slogans that they were shouting together, you would know immediately that this was a protest march. Because you can see the ritual language of a march like that is a protest march. If you went to New York on Thanksgiving and you saw a giant floating Snoopy, you would know that that is not a protest march. That's a, whatever the Thanksgiving Day parade is, it's sort of an artistic celebration of the commercial and promotion of a department store. But it's a distinct ritual language that we're all familiar with. We speak the language of parades. We know what type of parades are there and what the significance is. There's some overlap, right? You know, there's some things that many parades have, floats and things like that. But on any given day, you could tell the difference between, say, a state funeral and a gay pride parade. That's just a given sort of ritual language that we all share. So in the ancient world, they had the same thing going on, but the ritual language was a little bit different. And what I want to tell you about Palm Sunday is that Jesus was using the ritual language of his time and place in order to make a new type of proclamation, a new procession. And for that reason, what he made was very much akin to some of the big processions of the time, but a whole lot dinkier. If you're ever in Rome, one of the things you ought to go to and you ought to see is the Arch of Titus. It's this big arch. It's in the Roman Forum. It doesn't go like, it's not a gate like to anywhere or from anywhere. It's just an arch just hanging out there. And on the inside of the arch, you can see the procession from when Titus came back to Rome after destroying Jerusalem. It is the arch that commemorates that victory. And on one side, you look up and you see Titus. And he's in a chariot pulled by 4 noble horses with just the biggest chest that you could possibly put on a horse. And behind him, the goddess Victory is putting a wreath on his head, and he's processing into the city. And if you look up on the other side, you see the spoils of war. You can see a bunch of people carrying a candelabra, or a menorah. It's sort of Josephus says it's not exactly like the menorah, but it was certainly intended to evoke the menorah. And the table from the temple, which allegedly was made entirely of gold, depending on which particular version they might have had. But it was sort of a parade of the spoils of war. And what that was a Roman triumph. Triumph is the word for a victory parade. And the Roman triumph had a certain ritual language. They would begin outside the city, and the people would go out to meet the victorious conquering emperor. And the victorious conquering emperor would be covered in garlands and wreaths and things like that. And they would process in with the most sort of stately and impressive military, you know, everybody in their dress, breastplates, and all of their best uniforms and their most strong people. And then, in addition to that, there would be just a massive display of wealth, the wealth of the nation that they had just conquered. And in addition to that, usually there would be some parade of prisoners, some sort of humiliation. In that particular triumph, in the triumph of Titus, the peasant general, Simon Bar Giora, who was one of the leaders of the Jerusalem rebellion, was brought in the front and sort of humiliated and eventually executed at the top of the hill. And then these processions always ended with a sacrifice to God, or for the Roman perspective, it was to the gods. So they started outside the city. There were wreaths and there were garments everywhere. It was the most impressive display of military might and wealth that they could possibly come up with. And it went all the way through the city, ended at the temple with sacrifice. Now, the Jewish royal procession had a lot of similarities to that, but there's just one thing that I want to bring up. It started outside of the city, it went into the city, it ended up on at the temple, and there was a sacrifice to God. But there's also a distinct note that there were always palm branches. Palm branches were a symbol of the Jewish kingdom at that time. So Herod always decorated his coins with palm branches. When Rome made a coin to commemorate the destruction of Jerusalem, the picture on the back of that coin is a palm tree with a woman crying underneath to symbolize the destruction of the nation of Jerusalem. Palms were united, were connected with the royal imagery of the court. Now, so that's sort of our ritual language of parades. That's what we've got going on for Rome and for the royal processions. In contrast, Jesus has a procession that is a little bit different, but shares a lot of the same bones. He starts outside of the city at Bethphage, which is off near the Mount of Olives, and he processes into the city. The people meet him outside of the city. And did anybody hear the word palm when I read the text? They didn't have any bones. They just went out and they cut whatever branches they could find from the field. They went out and cut branches from the field, at least according to Mark. John tells us that there are palms, but Mark, Matthew, and Luke all say variations. Actually, Matthew and Mark say variations of branches that they cut. Mark says that, this is a digression, they were cut from the fields. Matthew says they were cut from the trees. Luke makes no mention of it whatsoever, and then John mentions palms. So, point is, for Mark, and in this particular dynamic, there weren't any palms. There were just whatever they could find. It was not quite the same. Now, is Jesus wearing finery? Is there a procession of wealth? No. All he's got are the sort of traveling cloaks of the peasants that are around him. And does Jesus come in on a noble chariot with a massive army behind him? No. All he's got is these sort of Galilean fellas that have been hanging around, and the colt, the foal of the donkey, that's not even his, right? He borrowed it. And so what we see here is almost a parody of the Roman triumph, almost a parody of what was going on in those royal processions. Instead of garlands, they have branches that they cut from the ground. Instead of purple robes, they have cloaks that they put down. Instead of a gleaming saddle and an impressive horse, there's a donkey with some clothes on it so the ride's not too uncomfortable. And instead of a massive sort of military and wealthy procession, there's just a few people being goofy and shouting, and they're shouting, "Save us." So Jesus made his triumph in a different way from the way that the Romans made their triumph, from the way that the historic kingdom of Israel and Judah made their triumph. He made his triumph out of humble things. From all the way that we can look at it is there was intentionally, at least to some degree, dinky. And in each of those things, it's sort of a humbler version of what is going on in the Roman procession and in the royal procession. You could almost say that people are saying, save us, to somebody who's barely got anything more than the clothes on his own back. The other processions, they demonstrated strength in military might, in wealth, in victory, in dominance over the defeated. But Jesus is doing something different. He's saying that strength is not in any of those things, but in humility and obedience to God. Much like what Jennifer read us in Psalm 118, it is the stone that has been rejected by the builders. It's the one that was not good enough that has become the chief cornerstone. So, I bring all of this up to mention that sometimes things in church can feel a little bit dinky. We do not have the most impressive armies. We do not have the biggest finery. We don't have the resources of Marvel Studios to make a massive production. We don't have great production values. We don't have billions of dollars to turn everything into something beautiful. And we don't even always have enough people to make things into something really impressive and spectacular and dominant in the way that we think it would look best. We cannot, this congregation, cannot make the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade. We have a lot of things in our closets, and some of them are very surprising, but no sweet things. No giant Charlie Brown floats. We don't have the resources for that kind of thing. And in truth, it's not that we don't want things to be great, right? In everything that we do things to the best of our abilities because we want things to give glory to God. And one of the ways that we give glory to God is by serving God to the best of our abilities. But our strength is not in our production values. Our strength is not in the size of our budgets or even the size of our congregation. Our strength, at least according to what Jesus is proclaiming with this particular parade, our strength is in humility and obedience to God. That is the thing that can make us great. That is the thing that will deliver us to victory. This is, of course, a parody of a victory parade. It's not in providing a spectacle that competes with the biggest and most impressive modern spectacles that we can create. Our only breastplate is our breastplate of righteousness. Our only armor is the armor of God. And our only gifts, our only victories, are the ways in which we follow in the footsteps of Jesus, the one who chose humility over strength, the one who told us to love one another as I have loved you, and then showed us that love by picking up his cross and taking it to Golgotha on our behalf. What we're able to create is a product of the choices that we make. And I hope that in everything that we do as a congregation, we make the choice to choose humble obedience to our God over loud proclamations, spectacular production values, impressive visual effects. Though, if we got some, you know, like flames shoot up on the side, I think that would be okay. Our strength is not in any of those things, but in our ability to love each other. And so when we think about what it is that makes us a place of God, that delivers the victory that we hope to find in God, that will bring about our salvation, it is in the choice that we make to have imperfect worship so that everybody, regardless of race or age or sex or ability or sexual orientation can be a part of our service, so that everybody can be a part of our community. The things that we do might not be perfect, but they reveal a humble attempt to follow in the footsteps of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's where we'll find the victory that Jesus is telling us. And there's one last thing about the parade that I want to bring up, which is that if you noticed in my descriptions, all of the other parades ended in a sacrifice. And if you were paying attention to our reading for today, the procession of Palm Sunday ends kind of anticlimactic. Jesus goes into the temple and he looks around, and it was kind of late, and so he just went back to Bethany, which was 15 miles away, so I guess he had to get an early start. Nothing happens. It's an intentional, and Mark does this a couple of times, it's an intentional choice to remove that final climax, that final sacrifice. And it's a hint at what is going to be happening next week. Who will be the sacrifice, and how our victory will be won for us by a king who rides into Jerusalem. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.